worry about the existing file. So you don't have to have if-else blocks everywhere that, okay, the configuration is this, do this, those sort of things. Yeah. So, and like I said, like this is an intro section. So like if you get interested in this, like we can go through and like show you some of the examples. Okay. Then another thing is like it's error prone because it's not strongly typed. So you can, you are not required to declare variables. You can accidentally declare global variables and modify global variables anywhere, and then you may encounter issues. Okay, so that's like something new for most of the .NET developers. That again, now like they have to be really disciplined and make sure like all the variables are private, they have a good scope, and all that kind of stuff. But like once you get used to it, it's easy. But it's definitely like it's a like, you know, it's a difficult thing to get started. Then as I mentioned, like it's a bit difficult to debug as methods and objects can change on the fly. Okay. So like in general, like what I say is like, okay, now JavaScript has been there for so long, like so what has changed? Why are we talking about something like Ext.js or jQuery and all that? Okay. The reason is like really the web was developed for websites where you have like hyperlinks and then like media and all that, right? Web was not developed for business applications. So like even shopping cart was a big thing, like when it started, yeah, you can be shopping, right? But now like we are doing things like, okay, things like CRM applications, right? We are doing like things like email, which everybody thought like it has to be on the desktop, right? So now what has changed is like it has become a web application platform as well. Now, usually like one of the biggest change that Gmail and like, you know, things like Outlook web interface brought to the table is single page applications. So if you think about Gmail, like you don't really flip pages, right? It's just one page and like all the content is changing. But when you're developing ASP.NET applications in general, your pages are changing. So when pages are changing, what happens is when you switch from one page to another, if there was any memory leak that your code had, is gone, because now you are on a totally different page. Now when you are developing new applications that are single page applications, you have to think about that, because your objects are not never getting destroyed until you destroy them. Okay? And so like things like that actually come into picture when you have web applications coming. That's why like a lot of companies started using frameworks, because there are issues, there are memory leaks in Internet Explorer 6, and there are no bug fixes for it anymore. So you have to still deliver application to that. Now, do you want to write 10 different applications and handle those 10 different things again and again? No. But there are frameworks like jQuery that came into picture that basically normalized all the different kind of issues that different browsers had, and so that like you are just writing to a common infrastructure. So that's the abstraction layer that they created. Now, the good thing about JavaScript is like still it's interpreted, so most of these libraries do ship with source code. They do not try to obfuscate, because they realize that, okay, there's no point, because people will always come across things like they can solve. So with that, since you already know how they are trying to solve the problem, you can learn a lot from it. And if there is a bug, you can fix. So like, it's not like, okay, jQuery was written by one guy, or Ext.js was written by one guy. There were people who contributed because they could see what other people are doing, and then basically build on top of it. Okay, make sense? So for example, in case of .NET, okay, how many custom components you guys have created? Really, like which does totally something new. You may do something, okay, fine, if it is a text box, okay, you hit enter, then automatically it will summon. Or like it will show a mask character. But like beyond that, like creating a custom, totally custom grid, we always look for third-party components, right? Okay, if somebody already has solved that problem. But if we have to customize, we are always limited, because like the source code is really closed. We don't really know how a lot of things are being done. But if you think about where the world is going, almost all third-party vendors are coming with components based on jQuery or like JavaScript, right? We have Canva UI, we have Orbeez from Syncfusion. Like almost everybody is coming with JavaScript-based components. Why? Because they also realized that, okay, where are we running this code? We are running this code in the browser. So why do we need an abstraction layer? Okay. And with this, what happens is .NET actually like serves a big purpose. Now developers can focus on all the complicated stuff, and the UI developers can focus on the presentation. And that's where like we have seen a big boost in quality of applications, because now like both are testable separately. You can test the UI separately. A lot of error handling has to happen. In .NET, you don't even think that, okay, fine, if I submit and connection is broken, what is going to happen? Do you handle those cases? Usually you don't, right? You just have a on-submit handler in the backend that will do something. You don't have that, okay, what if like between the submit and the server, you will just see, okay, 500 error or something of that sort, right? But when you're writing Ajax-based application or JavaScript-based application, you write always that, okay, this is what when it is successful, this is what you do when it is failed. Make sense? So that's like, you know, it's a shift in thinking of how we are developing applications. What is going to the user and what is going to the application? There is a difference between those two. Make sense? So .NET is serving to the application, it is not directly serving to the audience that is going to use the application. Okay? Now, web applications, again, like they became popular because like they can be used on thin clients. A lot of our clients are using like on like, you know, dumb systems, like they just have a browser, they don't need anything else because there's not much of power needed. Like you can't go beyond browser, right? You don't have access to anything. And then another thing is like they don't have to distribute updates. So you update the server, everything is updated. So that's a big win for a lot of clients. And like, it's not like it's just like HTML plus JavaScript that is delivering this. Like there is Silverlight, Java, Adobe Flash. They also deliver the same thing. But as I said, like, you know, HTML and JavaScript has become more popular because like it's a common denominator is the browser, and most of the people have browsers. Now even your phones have browsers. So like if I develop an application, you can load it in phone. It may not look that nice, but at least it will load. But if you write in say Java, you are out of luck. If you write in Flash, you are out of luck. Okay. Now, as I mentioned earlier, like Sencha products are not the only client-side framework. It's just like, you know, our preference based on like our analysis of a lot of frameworks. But different needs may have different, you know, suitable frameworks available to people. So like there is like Smart Client, which is actually much bigger, much better. Library than HTJS in terms of like number of components they have, but they always focus on Java, and they were actually there before HTJS actually became popular. But like since they are focused more on Java and like their writing style and the UI, the out of the box UI was not as appealing at that time, so it did not become as popular as HTJS. Okay, and like HTJS again, like you will see in like applications where you don't even expect. Like I've seen it in like you know. Things like MyFacts and like a lot of websites, like as you go behind the scenes. If you like if you look at the front end, most of the applications or most of the websites don't have HTTPS in the front end. They will be more into application like environments. Okay, where you have grids, so you have to do sorting, filtering, tab panels, windows, all that kind of stuff. Okay, so Kendo UI, jQuery, jQuery Mobile, UE, like there are a lot of libraries. It's not like UE is dead, UE is still there. They all already have a lot of components. So they are all like thriving. They have all their own usage. But as I said, like HTJS, because it has a commercial backing, so like you can always get support and all that. That's why like we chose HTJS. And we feel like it's very well designed. Now, like if you don't want to write native JavaScript, there are wrappers that are available. So for example, like for EHTJS, there is like a very common wrapper like EHT.NET. A lot of companies I've seen using it, a lot of institutions using it, just because they don't have JavaScript developers. But again, like in my experience, if you introduce that extraction layer, again, you run into the problem where like you have to extend or debug, you go into that loop again. But again, still, like if you want to get started with that UI, with that look and feel, you can easily get started with some of these frameworks. Okay. Then most of them started with website related components, like okay, we just need an accordion panel, we just need like, you know, menu and those kind of things. But then slowly and slowly they realized that's not where the money is, or that's not where the focus is. They started moving towards line of business applications and started packaging them up as like, you know, a full fledged feature set. Okay. So I know like I think like recently there was a tweet like about 92% of the websites run jQuery, something of that sort. I don't remember the exact number. But like if jQuery is that popular, then like, okay, where is jQuery useful, where is ext.js useful? Because ext.js is not that powerful because you will not see that on public websites. Because it's not meant for public websites. They did try something with, you know, like ext core, but it was never up to the mark of jQuery. Because one of the biggest things is jQuery is very lightweight. And it's general purpose library. Then you have like, you know, different components from different companies. So as I said, like, jQuery is best suited for websites, whereas ext.js is best suited for web applications, that is line of business applications. Okay? jQuery is focused on semantic development. What that means is like, okay, you declare divs, and so you still need to develop HTML. In ext.js, 99% of the times you don't even touch HTML or CSS. You just write JavaScript. Okay? So it's like when you're writing .NET, you just drag a grid. You don't really see, okay, whether it is drawing a TD, TR, or table, or what. You just drag a grid. ext.js works a lot same ways. Okay. Then, like, jQuery has lots of theming and widgets. ext.js has a lot of plugins and components, and like themes also. You can create your own themes also. Since it's all based on CSS, like they use some of the stuff, Compass and all, but it's not that easy. You can change themes easily, like if you want a new color combination and everything, it's easy, like you can do that. But if you really wanted something like, you know, really out of the world, then you have to know the CSS and HTML. Okay. So a lot of times, like 99% of the times, in fact, like what we see is like people roll out their application with the default themes only. Okay. And they have like really nice default themes, and we'll go through those in the demos so that you at least get an idea. Then, for the, like, all the components, like, you have seen, like, how many of you have really used jQuery components, like jQuery, like, so what kind of components have you used?
Theme picker is a big one.
Maybe accordion? And maybe just like adding some event handlers, right? Just to like, okay, click, do this and do that and all that. But when you need to, let us say, look for a component, let us say like you need to look for a tab panel, okay, I need a tab panel. So where do you go?
I have to cheat, I've actually used the ext.js quite a stuff.
No, but like in general, like if you have to go, like you just do Google and see, okay, there are hundred of like, you know, tools or components that are available to develop that same tab panel. Now you. Everybody has developed in their own way, their own style, and then you have to learn that. And the difference in ext.js is like, okay, there is one stop shop where like almost all the components are available. Okay, so they have like a similar kind of look and feel, so you don't feel that, okay, you have to customize a lot. So you can focus on what you have to deliver for your clients. You don't have to focus on, okay, how do I customize it to match my demand. Now, on the other hand, if like you have a company logo and company color combination and everything, you have to customize the theme. It's a lot of ask to like customize the theme. Now it's easy, but still like it's an ask. Okay. Now, jQuery has been free from day one, like it's a MIT license. ext.js does cost money. ext.js is not free, as I said, like it's available as GPL. So, but like most of us like develop products like which are like daily products and commercial and all that. So like you have to pay a license fee. And jQuery is open source, ext.js is also open source, in the sense you get to see the source code, but at the same time you can't really like, get access to the trunk. So they have closed source development, but when they do a release, then the source code is available. So if they do 10 bug fixes, so let us say like 4.2.1 is out, now they do bug fixes and they release 4.2.1.1, that it's not going to be available. Community, it's only for the paying customers. When they release the next minor version, then they will release it. So there is a differentiation. So there is a cost involved with using the ext.js. Okay. Similarly, like for the mobile, like we have jQuery Mobile versus SensaTouch. Again, jQuery Mobile like started way later than like SensaTouch. Earlier, like it was JQ Touch, which was started by some of the guys like. Who basically joined Sencha later on, contributed all their work to Sencha, and that's what like Sencha Touch started with. And then like jQuery Mobile has a wide platform support, like almost all the different phones are supported. In case of SensorTouch, it is limited. It is available on iPhone, it is available on Android, Windows Phone, BlackBerry now, like Bada OS, we don't know, but like there are a lot of like phones that are supported now, but initially they were not supporting Windows Phone or like BlackBerry, because like it was not really like, they are going after like what is the common thing, whereas like jQuery has been trying to support as many phones as well. So again, like jQuery Mobile has like lots of theme, but performance is improving, but still not at par. But SensorTouch, as I said, like performance has been improving day by day. Like it's every release, the performance has been improving tremendously. Then, like if you already know jQuery, then it's easy to do jQuery Mobile. But in SensorTouch, again, like it's MVC and like component based, so like you still have to learn all the concepts, which is again, like as I said, is a big ask to move from the .NET world to JavaScript. Again, like both have like a lot of third-party plugins and modules available, and SensorTouch like marketplace is limited, but still like it's growing, and like most of the times, whatever applications we have been developing, we have found almost solutions for almost everything that we need, whether it being like a map component or date picker or anything. So we have found anything, we have not found any issues. So as I said, like again, SensorTouch is free. Free meaning like even for commercial use, but like limited upgrades for free users. Meaning like if they have a point release, they don't really give it to the community for free. You have to be a subscriber of the support package. Once they release a major update, then they release it for free. Okay. Then things like Sensor Charts, which are HTML5 based charts, they have moved to like a subscription package, so you have to have subscription before you can use Sensor Charts. Now again, like our thoughts are like jQuery Mobile is easy to use, SensorTouch is difficult to get started. Communities on SensorTouch is not as big as jQuery, because jQuery, as I said, like it's like widely used. But again, like what we have found is like it's comparatively faster and better for larger applications. If any application I'm developing, I will like application in the sense like it has complex business logic, business rules, and all that kind of stuff, I'll still go with like SensorTouch. If it is something simple, like you know, converting like a shopping cart or something, simple things, then I'll still go with jQuery Mobile. Now, one of the things that I do want to mention is what we have seen is a lot of packaged applications like that were being developed in on native platforms are being moved towards SensorTouch. So, like SensorTouch is definitely like gaining a lot of traction in that space. Because SensorTouch applications can be packaged using SensorTouch Packager, as well as using PhoneGap. So they have their own packager also, so like which can be used to package on like even Windows platform for iOS and stuff like that. Okay. Now, I just wanted to give you a couple of demos on HTJS and SensorTouch, but I think like it might be better like if we take a break and then we go through the demos so that maybe guys like have any questions or things like that.